here, so we can start.
So you're the hostess now.
Okay. So we are here again. Let's get started with our half day French Italian half day session. And this, I'm very happy, delighted to moderate a French Italian panel discussion with recruiters, French and Italian recruiters of PhD graduates. And we have already spoken about mobility, the differences between carrying out a PhD in Italy and in France. And the topic comes again. There are for sure differences in the recruitment process in Italy and in France. And we are here with real professional HR professionals. So I'm very thank you for your participation, for giving us your time. You are very, very busy. Ferrero, Filippo Armellino, HR business partner at Ferrero. He has already taken part to different activities, initiatives organized by our university in Torino, such as mock interview with real HR professionals. So he knows that we are deeply committed in the career development of PhD. We're trying to help them to prepare their next move. And then let me introduce Nadine Graal. She is head of recruitment and she's also in charge of a relationship with university and schools at Capgemini. Eva Ratti, general manager, Find Your Doc, the only Italian start employment agency, specialized in PhD graduates, helping them to find an adequate job outside academia. And Alice Vernata, HR specialist at Leica Microsystem. So two Italian and two French, and I leave the floor to Ferreros about what happens in the hiring process. What are you expecting from our PhD graduates? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's always a pleasure for me to be here and to, let me say, have the opportunity to talk about PhDs with PhDs and about the process we have in Ferrero. Even because, as you know, we had the opportunity to hire specifically PhDs especially for some roles in the technical areas, but not only. So today I will tell you something about the recruitment process in Ferrero. Okay, basically, everything is almost detailed in our Ferrero Career internet site, but I can detail it. We have a couple of different entry points. The first is for newly graduated, so if you are out of the university, just out of the university, and up to 2 years of experience in the job experience. In this case, the first step in the recruitment process after you have applied to a job post in our Ferrero Career site, because basically the first step is to go on our Ferrero Career site, see all the job posting that we have all around the world. Every single job that we have is posted there. Our policy basically required that all the HR posted all the position before internally, so it's an internal job post previously, and then after a couple of weeks we go outside, and so there every 15 days more or less you can see the new post. So you go there, you look at the position you think is in line with your profile, you post with your CV, As I said, if you are newly graduated or with a couple of years of experience, first step are GMA test. GMA test, you know, it's a verbal, logical, numerical test plus an English test. If the result is positive, then the second step is an assessment center. An assessment center that we applied at the first stage instead of the test, if you have from 2 to 4 years of experience. So if you have already 2 years experience, do not have to do the test, just the assessment. The assessment center is a classical assessment center, group assessment. So basically an entire day. Today, with after the COVID situation, we are doing this assessment center via video conference. Of course, it's not ideal, but it's what we can get in this moment. The three main moments are the in-basket questions, role play and the interview with a psychologist, because this assessment is done by an external company that supports us in this. And during this assessment, we verify the compliance of the person with the Ferrero competencies. We have six main competencies that are basically soft skills that we think are important to be successful in to work in our company. And so these competencies are evaluated during the assessment. For some roles, we go deep diving some competencies in particular. For example, if you have to work in the R&D department, of course, I have to check better about the strategic thinking, for example, no? And so on. So basically, after the assessment, if the assessment is positive, the next step is an interview with the HR and the hiring manager. So the first interview, nowadays the first interview is a video interview. I think we will stay in the video interview as a first step even in future, because it's pretty effective. And then if the first interview is okay, then it's the other step, and probably the last step usually, it's another interview live with the manager of the hiring manager and the HRBP senior. Usually we close the process with these steps. If you have more than 4 years of experience, then you jump directly to the interview process. So basically, this is the process.
Thank you for this very detailed explanation and presentation. This is how it works at Ferrero, the big Italian company. Could you please maybe give us the website link to have more detail, to see maybe are there any example of a GM test if I want to maybe to be hired by at Ferrero, so I can prepare. How can I prepare? What kind of CV do you prefer? Because in Switzerland, for example, it's different. Mm-hmm. So are there, do our PhD graduates or PhD students at the end of their doctoral paths find this kind of information in your website to prepare their job interview, their CV, to be a little bit strategic? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
This is the website. Then I can send also you the link for the preparation of the test. Okay, about the CV, I mean, we have, I mean, leave also the colleagues to speak about that, but it's not so easy because we have a lot of different opportunities today. We have the European survey, but it was not so successful, let me say, in term of use. So probably the Anglo-Saxon survey, the American survey is a little bit more easy to read. But then in my previous experience, I was having interviews with the creative people for the graphic, and I found a lot of different CVs, very colored and so on. So it depends also what the message you want to send, no, with your CV. Of course, the basic point for me is that as HR, we have not so much time to read the CV. We have tons of CV to read. I need to find the important information very easily. Otherwise, I skip to the next.
Yes, yes, it is true. They have to learn, our PhD students have to learn to write a very synthetical and very concise, but at the same time, to the point, CV, because you have just explained that we have not so much time to concentrate on so many CV. So if they have to think strategically and to prepare the right CV and to read, this is very good. The fact that you have a website, Ferrero Career, so they can find lots of information.
And if I can, due to the fact that we are talking about PhD, and I know PhDs correctly cares a lot about publication and articles they wrote and whatever, very useful, but it is in a second step. In the first step, if you put in the CV all the article and CV, maybe get the CV too long, can be ineffective. The second step, in a technical interview, of course, it's important.
There is a question in the chat. Should the CV maybe, I don't, the please, could you please also introduce your name, Fucci, your university of origin? Anyway, the question is, should the CV be sent in Italian or in English when applying to a job in Italian at Ferrero?
For Ferrero in English.
In English, so they have to write yes, because anyway you are present worldwide, so
it's better in English, even because English it's mandatory. So
yes,
as a language, so it's the company language. So we prefer to have the CV in English. Then of course for an Italian position, it's okay even in Italian, but let me say, in English, it's better.
Okay, thank you. So anyway, I think that so Ferrero is interested in PhD graduates. Do you hire PhD? Many of our PhD graduates are there. So this is a good news. This is something to encourage our PhD to prepare their CV, their mock interview, and then maybe to apply for a position in at Ferrero. I think that thank you so much for your insightful presentation. And so I will leave the floor to Nadine Graal. Then Capgemini, I had a look to your website, so you are very innovative. Could you just say a few words about your company and about the different steps of your recruitment process and the kind of profile you are looking for?
Thank you, Lucia. Hello, everyone. So maybe I can give you some information on the context, a specific context of Capgemini Engineering before giving you some information on the process. So because it's important to know that Altran, we were Altran one year ago, and Altran and Capgemini have recently merged to create Capgemini Engineering. So now we are the leader, the world leader in consulting in the field of digital transformation. So within Capgemini Engineering, so a new entity in Capgemini, we support our clients in our strategic challenges. So we have a part of activities of our activity dedicated to the consulting activities and projects. And the other part, I am today here to speak about the research and innovation. So it's a specific part in our activity. So we have many research and innovation projects internal that we work internally in our company. So not dedicated directly to our clients. So in Capgemini Engineering, we are today 52,000 employees, and we are present in 30 countries in the world. And now from 10 years now ago, we developed an internal research to anticipate, in fact, the strategic needs of our clients and to help them thinking about all these subjects before and through our research and innovation projects. So now we have 8 research and innovation projects, and they are very multidisciplinary. So we deal with e-health, mobility, aero, rail, and mobility in generally, as well as the industry of the future, the networks and data. We speak about AI as well, energy. All the future of work as well is one of our last programs that we created. So we hire as well in the field of human and social resources.
This is interesting.
So it's a specificity maybe because it's quite new. This program is new. We launched it 1 year ago now. And it's an opportunity as well for the PhD in that field to develop research in a company and enterprise because it's very interesting because we have a nice research area, in fact, in our company. You can as well analyze management evolution, the company transformation, and many subjects like this. Social aspect as well of the industry. So now we have 120 internal research projects in France, and we have 180 about 180 PhD working with us on this project all over France as well. So as well, the last point on the context is that we developed like a network of innovation lab. So that there are really innovation laboratories, open space for meeting and collaboration as well, where we can experiment with new working methods. And as well, we can work on prototypes and new concepts in our labs. So I wanted to speak about that as well, because it's sometimes very interesting for PhD to know that they can work in laboratories in our company, and we have space for that type of research. So now in terms of recruitment, we are looking for 2022, we are searching for about 100, between 100 and 150 PhD that we would like to hire on our projects in all the disciplinary and area. So engineering, but as well data science and human resources, social and human resources.
So multidisciplinarity is widespread in your company. And so we have lots of multidisciplinary PhD programs. And about human and social sciences, because you know it is always a little bit difficult for humanities, human and social sciences to to access to be hired by companies. So you said that there are opportunities for them. Maybe could you tell us something more about the kind of, if possible, precise profile you are looking for them? Because I know there are PhD graduates attending our webinar today coming from this area. Thank you.
So we are looking for psychologists working on the field of work area as well. We have anthropologists with us. We have sciences de gestion, management science. About this type of
program. Thank you. And about the recruitment process, it happens the same. Filippo Mellino from Ferrero explained different steps. And what about your company? How do you organize job interviews, the different steps of your recruitment process?
Okay, so of course, as Filippo, our career website is one possibility to send your candidature for one opportunity or one position, specific position. But as well, I use the website, the ABG website, to post the offers, for example, as well. So it's another way. I can as well. So I have I work differently for PhD recruitment because I think specific recruitment events are more efficient for me. So specialized career fair, like the PhD career fair one per year, we have a big career fair organized by the PhD talent in France. And I think it's a very good opportunity for PhD to meet us one time. As well, the conferencing in university and the meeting or the days organized in university with enterprises. It's very interesting because it's really a day specific for PhD. And we can speak about many thematics around the PhD. So I think it's a very good opportunity as well. And then when the meeting is done, we could say we begin with the validation of the profile with the CV. So like Filippo, it's very important to give vulgarized information, but as well, I think it's not a problem for me to receive a CV from a PhD with as well the publication information, because it's not a problem for us to have this information. Of course, it's very interesting to see which publication you did as well. It's important. Okay. Then we have a pre-qualification after. So often we do it by phone to have some information about the mobility, the salaries the candidate would like to have, but as well the more administrative, I would say, at the beginning information. It's a first meeting, but very short. Then if it's okay, we can go with a technical meeting, and then one or two technical meetings. Some divisions, some departments are doing as well very specific technical tests, but not all our division. Not all the departments. And then we have one HR meeting and then one meeting with a manager. Because what is specific for us is that our research projects are sponsorized by a division, an operational division. So it's important to have as well their validation. So we could say we have three meeting during the process, the recruitment process, and then if all it's okay, we can make a proposition of a contract.
Okay, thank you. There is a question. Do you hire a PhD without experience in a company?
Yes, of course. We hire a PhD just after the PhD or after a postdoctorate as well, or after maybe with an experience. So it's not a problem for us. The only thing is to be able to explain what was your project.
Okay, and this is a great question. So for you and Ferrero, and then we will go on with the others. So what about negotiation? As far as I know, in Europe, in some country like Switzerland, during the hiring process, the last step of the hiring process, the candidate can negotiate or ask something about his salary, his her salary. Is that possible at Calgemini and at Ferrero, or is it better not to treat this topic, salary? So let's start with Nadine and then Ferrero. Okay.
We can negotiate the salary. It comes at the, so during the pre-qualification, in fact, we ask for the pretension and the candidate, because if it's not really not possible for you and for us, and it's not compatible, I would say it's not worth going, and you will lose time, and everybody will lose time. So it's important to ask this at the beginning
for to us. Clarify from the to very clarify. Beginning. And what about Ferrero?
But if we are talking about newly graduated, it's no. Easy because because we have a national contract, no? You can find the entry level there, and also the amount of the salary. Of course, with someone with experience, we usually ask for the expectations, and we try our best in the offer. We make the offer at the end of the process, and we discuss with the candidate the offer.
It's the same for us. The discussion is done at the end of the process, but the expectation are asked at the beginning, so that we can see if the gap is if there is a gap, or if we are aligned on the.
If the candidate meets somehow your requirements, or if the candidate doesn't meet your requirement, in that case it is a waste of time to keep on to go on. And as I have understood this, that Capgemini and Ferrero, so they hire different kind of profiles, and there is also hope for from the human and social sciences as psychologists. Is that the same for Ferrero?
Yes, of course. The opportunity are less because the area that we have in which we can hire such profiles are area with less people in the company. So, such as HR or legal or so basically, it's not the R&D part that is much more. Populated. So said that, yes, of course, we are also degree about humanities degree, yes, a PhD. Okay. It happened less that PhD applied for our job posting in humanities area. It's difficult to find someone with PhD that applies for HR or for legal.
Okay. As for us, it's difficult to have candidature for the moment, but we think it's maybe because it's not known, because the program is new. But yes, if I post an offer for this type of position, it's more difficult than for engineering.
Okay, and before the last question to Ferrero and Graal, and then we will concentrate on Find Your Doc and Alice Bernata. In three words, an advice, a tip to our PhD students and PhD graduates attending our webinar today. When they, if they want to work at Ferrero and they want to work at Capgemini.
Let me say, be focused on what you are looking for. So be focused on what you want from your career. Be passionate, because this is something that makes a difference. Enjoy yourself, because in the end, if you decided to do this career, it's because it's something that you like, and you have to do it until 70 or more. So better to enjoy, no?
Yeah, be enthusiastic. Otherwise, it is impossible. It is unbearable. Okay, and according to Nadine Grass, so a piece of advice.
Yeah, I think
with you at Capgemini.
Yes, it's Philip. What Filippo said. The same for us, but I think in the research and innovation, what is important is the passion. So for the subject as well, and I would say another advice would be to try as well to think about all the experience you had during a PhD, and to try to transpose what you learned during this quite nice experience, and trying to express that in the meetings we have, the interview, because it's very interesting. And sometimes I see that some candidates do not see the richness of their experience, and it's very important to be proud of what you already done, and try to express that.
I agree with you. Sometimes they're not aware of their full potential, and they can, I will go on with the other two speakers, Eva Ratti and Alice Vernata, and it's about awareness, find your doc. This is the job of Find Your Doc, to help PhD graduates to become aware of their full potential and to sell their potential beyond academia and innovation and so on. So if you can give us an overview of your startup and your mission in Italy. Thank you.
Thanks, Lucia, for having us, and hello to everyone. Lucia, if you want, I did prepare a few slides, but you tell me if you prefer that I put
If you want to, can you put them on the screen? And
yes,
you can,
I will also share the screen.
Okay.
First of all, I will tell you a little bit about who we are, because of course our name is not as big as the ones we have today on the table. Yes. So as mentioned by Lucia, Find Your Doctor is a job agency and an innovative startup, the only one in Italy, and I think almost the only one in Europe, together with some realities in France, who is dedicated to PhD graduates only, PhD graduates and people with the same level of academic research experience. We operate through a website where we have more than 6,000 researchers profiled across all disciplines and all around Italy and some abroad. Our hope is to become European eventually, but we are starting from the ground. We are a small enterprise, so we are not yet there. Of course, everything we do is free for researchers, but we offer to companies the opportunity to find professionals for their staff or just as consultants or trainers on particularly high level topics among our database, our group of researchers. So what we do, basically our mission is to bring the know-how of PhDs, of researchers everywhere this could be useful, in all the possible way that we can think about. The idea starts from our experience in our staff. Most of us are PhDs. I'm one of the two founders. I am a PhD in astrophysics. So we know what it means, what is the language of the academia, what are the mistakes that you make when you go out of it, the naiveness that you have, and on the other hand, the talent that you and the potential that you bring with you. And so our effort is to showcase this potential to companies, both the ones like the ones that we are hearing today, who already know and may find an advantage in the opportunity to easily contact PhDs, but they know what you're worth it. But also we try to change a little bit the perception of those companies who are not so aware of the PhD's potential. We also work a lot on PhDs. We do lectures within the PhD transversal courses of many universities in Italy. And what we try to do is exactly to give to the PhDs a little bit more awareness of their capabilities and of how to bring that outside the academic context. In fact, while thinking about what to bring to the table today, I had to think a lot. In the end, I decided to bring problems. In the sense that when we hear companies such as the ones talking today, we have the feeling that the PhD is well understood. And there are careers that are welcoming our experience. But we know that many PhDs are in fact afraid about the moment when they will have to leave the world of academia that they know, that they've learned about, and find a perspective in an outside world that is completely unknown. And in some sense, they are right to be afraid. Maybe it is different in France, but I would like to bring the Italian perspective from our point of view, where we indeed accompany PhDs in the companies. So we see them working together with the company people, with the R&D manager when we do scientific consultancy, with the recruiters when we accompany the selection process. We have seen the struggle happen and we have listened to the entrepreneurs and to the company people telling us all the issues they found in the interaction with PhDs. So basically, I think there is a lot of issues that are involved in the job matching process. Some do depend on the PhDs themselves, and I would like to go for last into those. Many depend on someone else, on the context. Some are more cultural, psychological, some are practical. For example, there are, at least in Italy, prejudices on what a researcher is. The PhD was introduced very late in Italy, and there is no much awareness of what is learned during a PhD course. They are perceived such as older master graduates, not as professionals trained in the innovation. There is an awareness on the market. There is a gap, a generally spread gap between academia and society, between enterprise and research culture that has to be filled. We are talking about this since ages. This is something the single PhD can do about with his or her example, but they cannot change alone, of course. Also, there is a lack of training in many universities about knowledge workers' tools. PhDs are the best representatives of what a knowledge worker should be. Knowledge worker is meant to be the worker of the future, someone who is goal-oriented, who is self-managed, with a set of soft skills that are very well trained in a good PhD, even though the PhD often don't know it. But in many cases, the PhD at the end of the course lacks some practical knowledge, such as how to handle funding or intellectual property. In many universities, they are trying to tackle this issue by offering courses on the topics. And so I think the situation is improving. There is a general lack of support in Italy from job agencies. As I told you, we are the only one who handle PhD profiles. And when I was looking for a job, I found that no one could handle the curriculum of an astrophysicist. They all told me, we don't do people like you. And sometimes they are, during the PhD, some professors even keep away the students from interacting with the outside so they don't learn the outside language. Or some recruitment tools are not helping much with a PhD because they use keywords that a PhD often don't have. Or maybe a PhD trained in the academia is used to describe his or her skills with words that are not the same that are used on the market. So these are things on the outside that many PhDs are aware about, and so they are scared. What should make the PhDs feel stronger, though, is that there is a lot they can do. And the most critical issues are, in fact, ones that they can tackle by themselves. Because one of the problems that we see happen in the job selection process very often is that is the unawareness of the PhD, not only about what they can do, but also about what they want to do, that comes out with the recruiter. Because they go taking an interview in a company, but they are not ready to leave academia. They are not sure. They think maybe they're idealizing academia, or they are idealizing the company. So they appear very naive. And when you put yourself on the market as an expert on something, to be so naive on other aspects, and especially so naive about yourself and what you want, undermines your credibility immediately. Yes. There is also, it's difficult to leave academia because being a researcher is an identity. And there is an interior step that you have to do when you decide to go out. And you have to make peace somehow with this choice, to understand it deeply, to know what you want and what you like. And then you have to learn about the market. Because there is a lot of unawareness about possible destination contexts for PhDs. Large companies with R&D, such as the ones we are listening to, are of course a fantastic destination because they already know us and it is slightly easier to communicate our skills. But on the other hand, they are not able to accommodate all of us. And not for everyone, the context of a large company is the best possible. Or maybe there are work-life balance issues that ask you to work in a certain area. And you don't find these kind of options there. But there is much more places where a PhD could find destinations. If we look at the statistics, in fact, the majority of us is creating their own job more than finding it. And we are not all going to Ferrero. So it is fundamental that you take time to discover what's out there. Because when you don't know, then you invent. And when you invent, prejudice kicks in. And then when you talk with a recruiter and you show that you are full of prejudices about the company and what's in front of you, it's not gonna go well. The same way you don't like to be looked at, you as a researcher don't like to be looked at in a prejudicial way, the company doesn't like it either. So we are trying to give our contribution with the courses, with the dissemination that we do, with the opportunities that we offer. We provide, for example, consultancy to companies, aggregating multidisciplinary teams of PhD holders or even students through our database. And we accompany them in the companies to face their problems, but with our help to ease the relation. This kind of experience is very training. It gives you the opportunity to put a step outside, even if you normally don't do so in your PhD. And of course, we also participate into contaminating labs, encounter opportunities with companies. We are being involved by some major manager associations in Italian right now to do a shared course, a shared experience between PhDs and manager with this scope to let you understand better what's the enterprise point of view. But there is a lot you can do by yourself. It's a job to find a job. And you are a researcher. So before you choose, before you apply, before you write your cover letter, Try to understand what are the expectations aside, how you should write a cover letter. Today, the HR managers are telling us they want it short, they want it to the point. What's the point? The point is that you have to showcase as fast as you can that you are matching the requirements, for example. So they don't want to hear the story of your life. They want to read in your cover letter and in your CV why you do fit what they need. And sometimes you don't exactly, but your know-how is transferable. Then you have to explain briefly how it is transferable. There is a lot that you need to learn. But first of all, you need to be aware that a PhD is not only your research topic. You heard that today before from testimonies of PhDs who find careers outside the academia. The PhD is like a shell structure. The research topic is at the center, but then there are layers and layers of learnings that you acquire without even realizing it. While focusing on your research, you do travel, you do interact with people in other countries, you learn language, you learn tools, you learn software, you become a fast learner. Maybe you become good in public speaking. Maybe you have to negotiate and become a good negotiator. Maybe you have to do a lot of grants and become good at that. You are becoming a professional of innovation. And even though being an innovator in the academia doesn't mean that you are in 1 second an innovator in a company, you do have the tacit knowledge, the soft skills to become one very quickly if you put yourself to it. So
Eva, thank you.
Yes, I'm closing. Eva,
sorry, there is a question because we have to keep to stay in time. They are asking you if you are the same as APEC in France. Maybe Christina has to help us. APEC is Association Professionnelle. I don't remember
this one. I don't know, to be honest. APEC is new to me.
Christina, APEC, they're asking in the chat if Find Your Doc is the same of APEC. I don't think that it is the same as far as I know, but maybe you are.
The same, not for sure, but maybe a similar thing could be, I don't APEC, know. APEC,
yeah, it's the organization when they're giving advice and also share some recruitment, help and also job offers. Usually they're less working with PhDs, so maybe it's quite similar in principles, but they're not working with PhDs.
I think there could be some similarities in the sense that we also provide orientation and we work with the universities to provide training for the PhDs, but we are actually a company on the market, so we work on the market with enterprises, we provide services. Is not only supporting the PhDs, but is also practically bringing them and their know-how to the market.
Maybe I can bring a very short answer. I would say that APEC is working with all sorts of executives. The C is for cadre in French, is executive. So from all levels, it's not only PhDs, of course. You would be closer from ABG, I would say, in your mission.
Yes, I would say.
Yes, the mission is very similar to ABG. Yes, indeed. Indeed. Yes. They, of course, are a reference point on many levels for us. Thank you. So I was, it was finished anyway. My message is given, I think.
So thank you, because you are, Find Your Doc, like ABG helps PhD graduates to prepare mock interview, job interview, CV in their webinars, because this is when you have to move to other sectors, you have to prepare it. You can't, otherwise it doesn't work. And maybe there is another question for you. Oh no, it was the same question. So thank you, Eva. Thank you for your presentation. Now Alice Vernata, HR specialist, Leica Microsystems. Thank you for joining us today. Another innovative company. We would like to know something more about your company, about the hiring process, the possibilities, because PhD have full potential, maybe they lack the awareness, but which kind of profiles are you hiring, and your advice, your piece of advice to our audience here. So.
Yes, good morning, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much. First of all, can you hear me and see me well?
Yes, yes.
Okay, great. So, well, I hope to find you well and that you're enjoying this super useful event. And well, just a few words to present myself and the company I work for. I'm Alice Vernata, and I'm the HR specialist in Leica Microsystems. And in particular, my focus is on all the HR activities for South Europe, so for Italy, Spain, and Portugal. And for those who don't know Leica, maybe you have already heard about it, talking about cameras, but actually we are Leica Microsystems, and our core business are not cameras, but microscopes. So we develop innovative instruments linked to microscopy, digital microscopy, confocal laser, okay, and surgical microscopy, with offices all over the world. And we are a German origin company. And at the same time, from 2005, more or less, we are part of a bigger American group called the Danaher, which is a global innovator composed by more or less 20 operating companies, all focused on innovative technologies. Directly on our site, you can all find all the open positions that, that are open all over the world in every country. And well, of course, you can apply directly there, and you will always receive a feedback directly from us, positive, of course, negative. And if positive, of course, the interview phase starts. So today we should talk about recruitment processes, and I don't have so much time, so we go directly to the point. And I will start talking about my personal experience, since I've started working in Leica as an HR just more than 1 year ago. And every time that I tell people, to my friend, that I'm in HR, both those with a degree similar to in technical aspects, in scientific aspects or not, they used to ask me which are the answers that HR expect to hear from a candidate during the interviews. And every time it's hard to answer, because there is not a correct or wrong answers. It depends, of course. So generally speaking, concerning Leica, there are two types of interviews. The one held by the direct manager of the position, which are generally based on technical aspects of the job in order to test your specific and technical knowledge and competencies. So for example, if you want to become an account manager and advance the workflow specialist, you need to know how a microscope works, of course. Otherwise, if you apply for an HR position, a finance position, a credit collector position, it's different, of course. And then there is another kind of interviews held by HRs, and we need to find out different aspects than, of course, the managers. So there are some key words, let me say. First of all, I would say personally, soft skills. So we need to find out if you can, you know, communicate, manage priorities, working group, listen, communicate, manage stress and deadlines, being emotionally intelligent, and so on. And of course, it depends on the position you applied for, as my colleague from Ferrero already said, it depends on the position. So, and the main question that you could think is, how can we understand if you have or not this kind of competencies? Well, actually, your CV can be really useful, but not so much. So we will find out if you have that kind of competencies by making questions and listening to what you say. So talking about this, I would say, just like a sort of tip, just be ready to answer during interviews to open questions about your past and present professional experience. And don't worry if you don't have so many or if you do not have at all, since it's the beginning. So maybe you can just explain, making examples of your life. I can make my examples. So when I did my interview for Leica, I've never worked in a team group. I already had a professional experience, but I never worked in a group. But at the same time, I've played volleyball for 13 years, so I can say that I know how to manage a team group. So I just use that example, and I'm not saying that it's the perfect one, but it helps. So I can, as an HR, maybe I can understand if you are ready to work in a team. A second fundamental aspect that as an HR I need to investigate is you're willing to learn, especially if you've never worked in a company, but you have previous experiences somehow. So I need to know if you're ready to learn and to face new and unknown situation. And it's absolutely very difficult. It's not something easy for anybody, but it's the beginning of your path in the company. Therefore, I need to understand if you're ready and to learn. So don't worry, also here, HRs will make you open questions. Just make example, explain what you did in your past experiences and go on. And the third and probably most important point is, as far as I'm concerned, is motivation. So, and these three points are fundamental for every kind of PhD you're doing. Even if you're not doing PhD, it's fundamental in every kind of interview. If, and as an HR, I'm not feeling that you're really interested in this application, in this job position, I will probably look for other candidates. And that's fundamental. And so this is the three main points: motivation, willing to learn, and soft skills. And what I can tell you is also, don't be afraid of interviews. You can be excited, you can be also a little bit worried, but don't be afraid, and don't be afraid to make mistakes. That's just my really personal tip, since if it's the first time you try to do that, it's normal you could do mistakes. So don't be afraid. Go on, and this should be an exciting moment, so enjoy it. And well, that's all from my side.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Sounds very interesting. I read in your short biography you are based in Italy.
Yes, I am.
So where in Milano, where are you based?
Yes, I'm based in Milano. Our main office in Italy is in Buccinasco, which is near to Milan. But our main office, of course, in Germany. But we have multiple offices in Spain, in Germany, in France, in England, and Singapore, Dubai, everywhere. Yeah,
wherever. And yes. And so for Italian PhD, it might be interesting the fact that you are, so they can come for an interview in Milano, near Milano.
Actually, nowadays, no, we just do it virtually because of COVID, of course. But before, yes, it was
now everything is online.
Yes, actually, I can tell you that it depends, because we are a really global organization, a global company. For this reason, it could happen so many times that maybe your direct colleague or your manager is not Italian and is not based in Italy. So maybe if you are applying for a position in Italy, maybe you will have the interview with the manager virtually because he's based in Germany or in France and so on. And with the HR, possibly, thanks to COVID, possibly in the office, otherwise also virtually.
Okay. Any question from the audience? And about your profile are more so hard sciences, the profile you're looking for.
Yes, actually, of course, sometimes there are open positions for credit collector, HRs, finance, office administrator, and so on. But we have less position than, of course, account managers, then advanced workflow specialists, standards, and so on, who are those really prepared on microscopes, those who have contact with the customers and so on. So it's something really specific.
What is the rate of your PhD graduates you have? You have already, you have hired, you have in your company?
Well, we had some PhD. Actually, we managed the hiring of a PhD just a few months ago in France, I remember. And well, it's not something really mandatory for us. So you do not need to have a PhD to sell microscopes. So if you have it, of course, it's something more. You have more experiences, more competencies, and of course, it's very useful for you, for each of you. But it's not mandatory for us. For example, we have and of course we have every kind of open position. So like a manager, and of course also for internships, apprenticeships, and this kind of lower position, which can help you to grow step by step, maybe at the beginning. Otherwise we have every kind of positions open. And the most important thing I can say, at least for us, is English. So this is the only thing that it doesn't matter if you have PhD or you just did the primary school, you need to learn to know English. Yes, that's the first thing. So, well, if there are no questions, I just want to say—
Ah, there is a question. There is a question. Company, okay. Do you practice international mobility? So if I recruited in Portugal, can I go for a mission in Singapore?
Well, in general, I can tell you that it depends on the job, on the position you're covering. So, for example, I know that account managers travel a lot. Of course, I can tell you that COVID has stopped so much this aspect, but we are going on, of course, fortunately. So, yes, it depends on also the geographical part that you cover. So maybe you're based in Italy, in Milan, as an account manager or as an advanced workflow, but you need to cover, you know, Spain, Singapore, Dubai, and you need to travel somehow. And it could also happen that if you want to move for personal reason in other country, maybe you can try to organize with Leica to be moved from Leica Italia to Leica Germany, to Leica France, to Leica Russia, and so on. Hope it answered.
Yes, it was. Thank you. It was very clear. It was
great.
Very clear. So I think that to sum up at the end of this roundtable discussions, so PhD are needed outside, both in Italy and in France. And this is the good news. So they can be hired, they have to prepare. Thank you for giving us so many insightful advice, tips, and tricks. And I would say that there is also hope for soft sciences, even if it is a little bit difficult, but maybe they can try. They have to look to search in your website, open position, and anyway, everything depends upon them, the way they prepare their job interview, their CV, their motivation, their awareness, their knowledge, I would say, of the company, of their company needs, and the awareness of their potential. If there are no other questions, maybe we can, or let's see. Christina, do you see other, can you see other questions? I don't see any other.
There's no more question. And since we had a very short break last time, so maybe we can take a break right now.